Welcome students to JEE session number 4. Today we are going to discuss few important topics regarding chapter number 6, that is work, energy and power. To moving to the very first question we have in today's session, that is question number 1. The question given to us is, which one of the following statement is not true? Which one of the following statement? Which one of the following statements is not true? Is not true. This is the question with us. The options we do have in this, that is the first option we do have, that same force for the same time causes the same change in momentum, the same change in momentum for different bodies. This is the first option given to us. Now I will check each and every option one by one in order to check which is not true. The first option they have given, the same force for the same time causes the same change in momentum for different bodies. Yes, the amount of force applied to a body, clear, the change in momentum depends upon what? Mass and velocity. Greater force, you will be able to notice that according to mass, if mass is more, velocity will be less, and if your mass is less, then velocity will be more. So here you will be able to see that the given statement is correct. The same force for the same time causes the same change in momentum for different bodies. First is correct. Let us check the second option we do have with us. Second option is, the rate of change of momentum of a body, the rate of change of momentum of a body is directly proportional to the applied force and is in the direction of force acts. Clear? Yes. Talking about the second option they have provided us, that is nothing but Newton's second law. The rate of change of linear momentum is directly proportional to the applied force, provided they have given that, and also is in the direction of what? Applied force. Here, second important point that is given over here, second option you can say, that is regarding what? Newton's second law of motion. The rate of change of momentum with respect to time is directly proportional to the applied force. I can say you, we do have equation dp by dt, and we know that d by dt, this is nothing but mv. More precisely, I can write m d by dt of v, that is ma, and this ma is nothing but what? Force. So I can say that the rate of change of momentum is directly proportional to force, provided the rate of change of momentum is in direction to the direction of the applied force. So second statement is correct. First is correct, second is correct. Let's see the third statement we do have in the question. The third statement with us, that is, provided a greater opposing force is needed. A greater opposing force is needed. A greater opposing force is needed to stop a heavy body. To stop a heavy body, to stop a heavy body and then a light body in same time, then a light body in same time, in same time. Also they have given in the statement, if they are moving with same speed, if they are moving with same speed. Yes, this statement is also correct. You over there have said that if the two bodies are moving with same speed, one is heavier, other is lighter, then large amount of force is required to stop heavier body then compared to what? Light body. So this statement is also correct. A greater opposing force is needed to stop a heavy body than light body in same time if they are moving with same speed. Now the last option they have provided to us, that is, the greater the change in momentum, the greater the change in momentum, the greater the change in momentum I do have, the greater the change in momentum they have given in a greater, in a given time they have told us the lesser the force needs to be applied, the lesser force needed to be applied. Clear? Here one thing you can mark over here, they have told that is greater change in momentum. Greater change in momentum requires what? Greater force. The reason behind that is Newton's second law. The rate of change of momentum is directly proportional to what? Applied force. If the change in momentum is more large, force will be large because they are directly proportional. So here their statement is the greater the change in momentum in given time, the lesser force. If this lesser is not correct, it's here you will able to notice it could be greater force. Why, sir? The change in momentum dp by dt is directly proportional to force according to Newton's second law. So if this is more, then this should be more because they're directly proportional. You cannot write lesser, but correct answer is greater. So this statement is, you can say, not true, and correct answer is D. Correct answer is D. Hope it is clear perfectly. Fine. Moving to the next question, we do have the second question we do have with us is a cell of mass 200 grams is fired by a gun of mass 100 kg. There are two data provided to us, mass of gun and mass of cell. Clear? So I can write over here, I do have mass of gun, that is capital M, that I do have, that is 100 kg. I do have mass of shell that is being launched from gun, that is small m, lighter in weight, that is 200 grams. Clear? So instead of gram, I can convert it into what? By 1000. So will be in kg. More precisely, I can write 0.2 kg. Is this clear? Okay, sir. Moving ahead to the next I do have, that is the muzzle speed of the shell is 80 meter per second. Muzzle speed of shell they have given. Muzzle speed of shell they have provided. That is small v. I mean right, capital V. Because if mass is small, then velocity will be more. So capital V is given 80 meter per second. They are asking them recoil speed of the gun is. They are asking recoil speed. So let us take recoil speed of gun. Recoil speed of gun to be what? Cap small v, and that is portion mark to us. Now here you can have to apply the law of conservation of linear momentum. Simple to get the answer, law of conservation of linear momentum. Clear? So law of conservation of linear momentum says that initial momentum of the system that is equal to final momentum of the system. Initial momentum of the system that is equal to final momentum of the system. Final momentum of the system. Now sir, how to calculate initial momentum of the system? I will tell you. At present, at start, you will able to notice that the gun was at rest. So I can write it out as what? M. More precisely, both were rest. The muzzle was on in the gun. The muzzle speed we do have of the shell. Or you can say shell was in the gun. So it was rest. I can write it, that is capital M plus small m, both were at the rest, so velocity will be zero. And in the final, I can write what? Mass of the gun, speed is small v. Mass of the shell, speed is capital V. Is this clear? So I do have equation 0 is equal to m small v, small m, capital V. Mass I do have, that is 100 kg. This I need to determine. Small m I do have with me, that is how much? 0.2 kg. Yes or no? And capital V, 80 meter per second. So this is going to be how much? 2 divided by 10. This is 0, 0 cut 60. So I am going to get my answer to be how much? V minus 100 V, that is equal to 60. So I am going to get my 16 divided by 100. Clear? That is how much? Minus. So I am going to get my answer V to be minus 0.16 meter per second. But here we will check that there is no 0.16 meter per second available. What you are going to do? I am going to do minus 0.16 into 100 because I do have unit over here, that is 16 centimeter per second. Make sure this is 16 centimeter per second we do have. We do have option 16 centimeter per second A, that is correct. But sir, here the negative sign. What this negative sign represents? This negative sign represents that the direction of the recoil of the gun is opposite to that of the launch of the shell from the gun. Till this clear? Okay, moving to the next question we do have. The next question we do have with us is a very interesting question. They have told that a block of mass M rests on a rough inclined plane. Let us draw the figure in order to get more clear. There is a block of mass M that is residing on an inclined surface. The coefficient of the friction between the surface and the block is mu. Here they have provided this coefficient of friction, that is mu. This is your coefficient of friction. They are asking to find out at what angle of inclination theta of the horizontal with the block is just slant to slide down. Means they are asking this theta, how much. This theta is question mark to us. Now, we know that the weight is going to be acting perpendicular down. Yes or no? The block is just begin to slide, means it's going to move down. So, frictional will be opposite to that. Clear, sir. Now, we know that the reaction is always perpendicular to the horizontal surface. So, this is your R. If I'll extend at the back, you will able to note that this angle is going to be theta, same as that of the inclination. Now there are two components of this mg. One component is mg cos theta like this. Another component, this will be mg sin theta, you can say. Clear? So from the geometry of the figure, what I can conclude? The very first thing you can conclude over here is, I can say that mg sin theta, that is equal to F. Frictional force and vertical direction, we do have two forces, that is mg cos theta, which nullifies reaction R. Till this clear? Okay, so this is equation 1, equation 2. 1 divided by 2, I am going to get mg sin theta, that is equal to F, divided by mg cos theta, that is by R. Mg, mg cancel, sin theta by cos theta, I am going to have F by R. Now sin theta by cos theta is nothing but what? So 10 theta. Very good. So it is 10 theta. Also, we do have formula at, that is the ratio of two forces. First is frictional force, that is frictional force. F is frictional force and R is normal reaction. R is normal reaction. We do know that the ratio of two forces, frictional force and normal reaction, going to give you what coefficient of friction between the block and the surface, the object and the surface. So we already know that F divided by R, that is nothing but mu. So I can write over here that is 10 theta is equal to mu. So theta is equal to 10 inverse of mu, because I was interested to calculate angle of inclination theta. So I got my answer to be what? Mu. So let us check for theta. Any option is 10 inverse mu? Yes, option A is correct, 10 inverse mu. Hope it is cleared perfectly. Moving to the next question. Very interesting question we do have with us. A small object placed on a rotating horizontal turntable just slips when it is placed at a distance of 4 cm from the axis of rotation. Let's think there is one turntable which is moving with some angular velocity omega. This is the axis of rotation. They are saying that one coin is placed or an object is placed at a distance of 4 cm from the axis of rotation. This is your axis of rotation, you can say. Clear? And it is placed at a distance of 4 cm. It slips off. Slips off means it's moved out. It's been thrown away from the disc when it is placed at a distance of 4 cm from the axis of rotation. This is the first data given in the question to us. Clear? It's placed at a distance of 4 cm from the axis of rotation. That is the first given. So I can say that R been provided to me, that is 4 cm. Clear? Distance from the axis of rotation. And it is moving with, currently moving with the speed omega. Clear? Now the second thing they have given, at what distance it should be placed in order to make it slip off from the turntable? At what distance it should be placed? When omega turns to be 2 omega, means it is rotating with the double angular velocity. Starting angular velocity was omega. Now it is 2 omega, it is moving with double angular velocity, and they are asking that at what distance you should keep that object in order to make it slip off from the moving horizontal turntable. This is the question. Means we need to calculate simply omega 2 over here. Omega 2 they have provided to us. Simply we have to calculate the distance from axis of rotation, means we have to calculate R2 over here, provided your omega 2 is twice of the initial, means it is doubled. Clear? Now what is the condition for an object to slip off? The condition for an object to get slip off from the turntable. I can write the condition we to have, that is centripetal force must be greater than equal to frictional force. Clear? Because in order to move on a circular track, circular motion, centripetal force is required, and which is provided by frictional force between the object and the horizontal turntable. Yes or no? So you can say that mv square upon r must be greater than equal to mu. Frictional force, we do have equation, coefficient of friction, that is nothing but ratio of what? F by r. So I can write f is equal to what? Mu r, provided your reaction is what? Mg. So my frictional force equation is mu mg. Hope it is clear. Now putting over here, that is mu mg. This is my what? Frictional force. Now see, they haven't talked about linear speed. They have talked about angular speed. So you should know the relation of linear and angular speed. V is equal to r omega. So I'm substituting over here, that is V r omega whole square divided by r greater than equal to mu mg. This m I'm going to be cancelled. I do have equation with me, that is r square omega square divided by r greater than equal to mu g. Here this one is cancelled, that is r. I do have r omega square greater than equal to mu g. You can remember this mu g is, mu is constant, g is constant. So I can write that r omega square is greater than equal to, or you can say it's constant only. It's some constant. This is my first equation I have got. Now from this equation, think over here. If I send this side, what I am going to get? I am erasing off. Clear? Hope till this is clear. Moving ahead. I do have condition over here, that what condition is? I got r omega square, that is constant I have got. See, I can write r is equal to constant into 1 upon omega square, if I am not wrong. Yes sir, you can send this omega over here. This constant, I can write now proportionality as 1 upon omega square. So I got one conclusion, that is the distance from the axis of rotation and angular speed square are inversely proportional. So from that I can get equation r1, that is equal to k 1 upon omega 1 square, and r2 is equal to k 1 upon omega 2 square. If I am dividing this 1 and 2, what I am going to get? R1 by R2, that is equal to k 1 by omega 1 square, k 1 by omega 2 square, kk cancelled. So I do have equation R1 by R2, that is equal to 1 by omega 1 square divided by 1 by omega 2 square. So simply I am going to get R1 by R2, that is omega 2 square divided by omega 1 square. Till this clear? Here you can say simply verify over here. These are inversely proportional. 1, 2, 2, 1. Means it shows that they are inversely proportional. Now what I have to, I have already values of R1. R1 I do have 4 cm. R2 I need to calculate. Omega 2, that is 2 omega whole square. And omega 1 is omega whole square. So I am going to get my answer to be what? 4 by R2, that is equal to 4 omega square by omega square. Yes? Omega square cancel. This 4, 4 cancel means 1. So I am going to get my R2 to be 1 centimeter. So the distance from the axis of rotation need to be 1 centimeter, so that the object will slip off, provided the horizontal turntable will move to the with twice the angular initial angular velocity. So here you have to check the options. I do have option 1, 2, 3, 4, 8. 1, 2, 4, 8 I do have options. The correct answer I do have, that is 1 centimeter. The distance at which the object need to be placed in order to get slip off from the horizontal turntable when its angular velocity is doubled. This is the basic conceptual question in regarding this chapter, or you can say the topic, that is what? Angular velocity. Clear? Hope it is perfectly clear. No doubt. Very good. Now moving to the last question of this today's session, that is very interesting question again. The question we do have with is, a particle is moving on a circular path of radius they have provided to us, that is 10 meter radius, 10 meter. At any instant of time, they have provided to us, at any instant of time, its speed is 5 meter per second. Its speed is 5 meter per second, and the speed is increasing at a rate. And they have provided one important thing to us, that is, the speed is increasing at a rate of, the speed is increasing at a rate of, at a rate of 5 meter per second square. They are asking to calculate, instead of 5, they have provided 2 meter per second square, and they have given the magnitude of net acceleration. The magnitude of net acceleration at this instant is dash. The option we do have A, that is 5 meter per second square, B, C, and D. Four options provided to us. 2, 3.2, 2, 3.2, and we do have last, that is 4.3. These are the four options provided to us. Now, very interesting question I want to tell you about this. They have given two things. The radius they have provided to us, that is 10 meter. So first data we do have, that is radius of the circular track, circular path, that is 10 meters. Clear? Second, they have important thing they have given to us, that is the speed. Speed, it is moving with 5 meter per second. The speed they have given 5 meter per second. They have given one more important thing. The increasing rate of speed they have given, that is 2 meter per second square. Rate of increase in speed they have given, that is nothing but, remember, that is nothing but 80, that is tangential acceleration. You can see the unit, it is meter per second square they have given. 2 meter per second square means they have provided us that 80, that is 2 meter per second square. Now, in order to get net acceleration, you should know net acceleration A square, that is equal to tangential plus radial component, and from that I can get A to be under root of radial component square and tangential component square. Now see one thing over here. This tangential component is already with you, but you don't have this radial component. Now remember, if object is moving on circular track, then this is going to give you what, your tangential component, and your radial component is like this. And if you want to get the net acceleration, you need to take resultant of to this. Yes or no? So one thing you can write over here, one thing you can conclude over here, that is this radial component AR is nothing but centripetal acceleration. This is nothing but centripetal acceleration. And we do have the formula for that. What is that? V square by R. So 5 into 5 and radius is 10. 1s are 2s. So answer is 2.5 meter per second square. Simple, I got AR. Clear? I have 80. So I can simply get my A, that is under root of, what is AR square? AR I do have 2.5 square. What is 80? That is tangential component. We do have tangential component to be what? 2 whole square. Tangential 2. Radial 2.5. If you solve this, you are going to get your answer to be what? So 2.5 square plus 2 square. If you are going to add this, you are going to get under root 10.25, which is going to give you 3.2 meter per second square. So your correct answer for A, net acceleration is 3.2 meter per second square, which is option C. Clear? Thank you so much. We'll see more types of questions into the next session. Thank you so much. Have a nice day.